What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. If you were to take a look at almost any data file on a computer, character by character, you would notice that there are many recurring patterns. LZW is a data compression technique that takes advantage of this repetition. The original version of the method was created by Lempel and Ziv in 1978 and was further enhanced by Welsh in 1984, hence the LZW acronym. Okay, LZW is a dictionary-based compression algorithm, meaning that instead of counting characters and building trees based on that count, such as we did for the Huffman encoding, LZW encodes data by referencing a dictionary. Thus, to encode a substring, only a single code number corresponding to that substring's index in the dictionary needs to be written to the output file. This dictionary starts with what we call the standard character set, represented by the first 256 ASCII code characters of the alphabet you see in front of you, and based on the provided input, the algorithm proceeds by enriching this dictionary with additional entries. Take this input text for instance, along with its starting dictionary, and let's try to encode it using the LZW algorithm. The first character we have here is the G, which is already present in the dictionary and represented by the code 103. Now remember, every time we find a match in the dictionary, we hold onto the character at hand and append to it the next character in the given string. So in this example, we hop to the next iteration and append to the G the E to obtain GE. Now, GE is not present in our current dictionary, so we create an entry for it, the 257th entry, then reset our iterating saved character to the current one only, which is the E, and finally append the code 103 to our encoded output. I know you're a bit confused, so let's proceed to the next iteration, and it will become clearer, I guarantee. Our next character is the second E of Geekific, which needs to be appended to the first one. Now EE is not present in the dictionary, so we add an entry for it, and add the respective code of E, which is 101, to the compressed output. After resetting the character to the second letter E, we append to it the K now, and do exactly the same thing we did with the previous characters all the way till we reach the dash between the two words. You see, LZW will need a few characters at the beginning to start populating and enriching this dictionary to use it later on in the provided text. And that is exactly what it is going to do when we reach the next repetition of the letter G. So, G is present in the dictionary, therefore we hold onto it and append the E. Now, if we check for GE, we will find it. And because we did, we also hold onto it and append the second E. Here, LZW will create an entry for GEE and add to the output the code representing GE. The more this particular sequence of letters occur, the more this algorithm will be able to represent them using less and less codes. The same is done for the remaining letters of the second Geekific word, until all of our text is now compressed. Now let's try to decompress this same output using the LZW algorithm. To do that, we will start off with the same dictionary we had, and we are going to make use of a very similar logic, but kind of reversed. Let me explain this. For each code number we have, we are going to check if this code is present in the dictionary. If it is, we hold onto it, check the one following it, and append their corresponding characters along with a new code to the dictionary. So, by the time we reach the code 256, a new entry for GE having a code of 256 will have been created in the dictionary, allowing us to identify this entry used by the encoder. Note that while adding new entries to the dictionary, you should only use the first character of your current letters alongside your previous set. So in this very iteration, GEE is added to the dictionary similarly to what was done while encoding. This method allows us to encode and decode without the need to provide to the decoder the dictionary created. It can work alone, and the only information it needs is the text itself. Contrary to Huffman, for example, where we need to provide the decoder with the tree created by the encoder. However, because of this, sometimes the decoder may encounter codes that aren't associated with characters, which means that no entry has been created for them yet in the dictionary. And to know the character associated with this code, we might have to guess it. Take this string as an example. It could be any alternating two letters. To encode it, and similarly to what we previously did, we create an entry for AB, BA, and ABA, and obtain the code sequence you see in front of you. However, while decoding it, we will encounter the code 258 before having inserted it. To deal with this exception, you simply take the substring you have so far, AB in our case, and concatenate its first character to itself. So AB plus A equals ABA, instead of following the normal procedure. As you can see, this turned out to be a good idea, as it led to the result we expected. Now that we know how to encode and decode a given text using the LZW algorithm, let's go ahead and try to implement it and start with the encode method. The first thing we need to do, as we previously mentioned, is create the starting dictionary of size 256. This dictionary will be a map, and to create it we have to loop over the integers 0 through 256. And for each integer, insert inside the map its corresponding string value along with its code value. While encoding, we have and know the characters and want to retrieve the number representations. That is why we choose to set the character as the key and the code as the value in the map. Now, for each character of our input text, what we need to do is check if this character, or rather the concatenation of this character and the ones following it, are present in the map. To include multiple characters in the same check, what we did was create a string variable and initialized it to an empty string. Then, the check was done on the concatenation of both this empty string and the character. The purpose of this is that, if the character is found, the empty string will be updated to store the actual character, so that in the next iteration, the chars to add variable we have here will represent both the previous and the current characters. Now, as soon as we stop finding an entry inside the dictionary for our characters, we need to do three things. First, we add to the output result the code representing the previous character we had. Then, we add to the dictionary a new entry for the characters that weren't found. And finally, we reset the empty string we started with to point only to the current character we are looping over. After we exit the for loop, there is one last check we need to do. You see, we looped over all of the characters and appended a code for each one. But what if the last code was a known code, like the IC characters at the end of Geekific of our previous example? If that is the case, then the loop exited without having the chance to add the last code to the result, and ended with the if statement and not the else statement. Therefore, we need to check if the string we are using to loop over the characters is empty or not, because if it isn't, then that's what happened, and therefore we need to append one last integer to the resulting output. With this, our input text is encoded. Let's try to decode it by implementing the decode method. The first thing we need to do here is also initialize our dictionary, which will also be a map. However, because we have and know the numbers here, and we need to retrieve the characters, it is best to set the integers as keys and the characters as values. And that is exactly what we did inside the for loop you see in front of you. The first integer of the encoded list always represents a character found in the initial dictionary, so our resulting string will start with that character, which we will retrieve and remove from the list of integers passed to us as input. Now, for the remaining integers, we are going to loop over them, and for each one, we need to check if the key set of the map contains this particular code. If it does, we retrieve it, and if not, we take the first letter from the characters we just had in the previous iteration and append it to the same set of characters. This is done to account for things like the alternating A and B example we gave a few minutes ago. Okay, next, this retrieved entry is appended to the resulting string, then the first character of this entry is appended to the characters of the previous iteration and added to the dictionary to generate the same entries as the encode operation. Finally, the characters of the previous iteration are updated to reference the current one to be able to proceed with our loop and with the remaining integers. Let's go ahead now and see our implementation in action. To do that, I created a main method and invoked inside it both the encode and decode methods we implemented. I also made use of the same example we saw at the beginning of the video. And as you can see, the printed codes are similar to what we previously got and are exactly as expected. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.